This program was produced a few months before the distressing Ayodhya events. Ironically, it seems even more relevant after December 6, 1992.
What is happening to our culture, our Sanskriti? Are we living up to the expectations of our freedom fighters who sacrificed everything so that we may live in a free country? Their vision of an independent India is eminently epitomized by Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore in a great little poem. I dare compare that vision with the reality today.
Where the mind is without fear and the head is held high, where knowledge is free, where the world has not been broken up into fragments by narrow domestic walls, where words come out from the depth of truth, where tireless striving stretches its arms towards perfection, where the clear stream of reason has not lost its way into the dreary desert sand of dead habit, where the mind is led forward by thee into ever-widening thought and action. Into that heaven of freedom, my Father, let my country awake. Without fear, and the head is held high. Where knowledge is free. Has not been broken up into fragments by narrow domestic walls. Come out from the depth of truth. Where tireless striving stretches its arms towards perfection. A stream of reason has not lost its way into the dreary desert sand of dead habit. Into ever widening thought and action. From that heaven of freedom, my father, will my country awake?
Why do you think there is this wide gulf between our grand conception and their actual realization? For instance, why is there such absurd violence and religious strife?
It's really not religious strife. They are often self-centered conflicts brought about in the name of religion. Well, let us look at a modern folk tale which may give us a clue to understand why things go wrong.
Once upon a time, but not so long ago, there was a little happy-go-lucky imp playing around in a certain strange planet. In another corner of the small planet, a wise man was in meditation. As a result of his many, many years of penance, the wise man had a vision of God. He got enlightened. Watching this, the little imp got nervous and worried. Restlessly, he rushed away. After a long voyage, the imp arrived at the fortress of his Asura king, the devil. Thank you. impatient imp tried to impress upon his master the gravity of the situation. But the devil was deeply involved in his game and had no time for the imp. Please listen to me, Master. The wise man has found God through enlightenment. He will propagate the truth and the brotherhood of man. We have no future since the truth has been discovered. Our kingdom may soon vanish, Master. Please do something. Eventually, the devil took pity on the imp and said,
"You little fellow, you are talking out of inexperience. We have faced the situation many times. Now that the wise man has found the truth, he will set up an organization, perhaps a religion, to propagate it. As usual, we will infiltrate it and try to take control."
Thus, if you notice carefully, you will find that the devil and his dirty team in disguise have infiltrated into almost every area of human activity, including religion. With their diabolical plan to control mankind, they propagate hatred, violence, and destruction. It is they who create conflict between the followers of one religion and another.
Is there no hope? Is it so bleak that humanity has lost to the devil? Fortunately not. Happily for us, there are men and women of great wisdom, even today, in every major religion, who continue to inspire us with their message of love, their message of peace and harmony, which in a sense is the true message of God. They are right here in our midst.
It appears that we have misunderstood the religion and its main teachings. There are principal teachings as well as practices of religion. Practices change according to time and place, but main teachings remain unchanged, immortal, and that must guide our conduct in this life. Man has debased religion either by ignorance, misunderstanding, or by selfishness. We see quarrel and fighting under religion. Strictly speaking, it is not religion. Many of the causes of the fight on religion is fight for personal gain. Therefore, it is necessary to understand the religion properly according to main principles.
Many things are happening in this world in the name of religion. We cannot call them religion at all. There are several missions and places of worship, and with their help, there are squabbles, wars, and conflict everywhere. We cannot call them true religion at all.
उसको हम धर्म ही कह सकते हैं। Vagarthayo sampurukto Pagartha privatteye Jagarath pitaro vande Parvati parameshwaro Mataacha Parvati devi pita.
Since God created the world, all human beings as well as all other living things are the children of God. Hence, they are brothers and sisters, and we must live in harmony with affection for all fellow beings as brothers and sisters. All religions accept the supremacy of God. All religions subscribe to the view that we are all children of God.
பாசத்தோடும் வாழ வேண்டியவர்கள் நாம் அனைவரும். உலகில் உள்ள அனைத்து மதமும் ஆண்டவனை அடிப்படையாக கொண்டு இந்த உலகம் இயங்கி வருகிறது என்பதில் அனைவரும் ஒப்புக்கொண்டிருக்கிறார்கள். ஆண்டவனுடைய குழந்தைகள் என்பதை அனைவரும் ஏற்றுக்கொண்டிருக்கிறார்கள். ஆகவே உலகத்தில் உள்ள அனைவருமே ஆண்டவனுடைய குழந்தைகள் தான். நாம் அனைவரும் சகோதரர்கள் தான்.
I often use it telling our as a friend, that if we use these two human hands in proper way, then that means, you see, if you look those fingers, it's not meant for hit, but mainly for, you see, hold two more people. So that means you've got two more friends. If you use, you see, these hands like this way, without much, I'd say, you use you see, these individual finger, but just like this, so hit for hit, then the result, you will be lonely. So therefore, even the physical structure of human being, I believe the harmony, cooperative, friendly.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Wa ma arsalnaka illa rahmatan lil alameen. God addresses to Prophet Muhammad, may peace be upon him. He says, that we did not send you, but blessing for all the creatures, for all the mankind. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam also says that we should love the people who are our neighbors. Either they may be believers or they may not be a believer. So here there is no distinction between the neighbors. There is another verse in Quran in which God says, La ikraha fi ddeen. This means there is no compulsion in the religion of Islam. So this verse clearly mentioned that nobody should compel anybody to change their religion.
Jesus Christ was the incarnation of love, and therefore essentially his message is one of love and peace and unity. He told us and gave us the great commandment of love when he said, love one another as I have loved you. And this message he proved when he died on the cross, saying, greater love than this no man has than that he lays down his life for his friends. Love, therefore, is the basis of our relationship with one another. Love brings about unity, harmony, and peace.
We must see that all human beings are one. There is one divine light in them, and we must endeavor, we must have awareness. This awareness can be achieved by meditation, by practicing Hinduism, by practicing Islam, by practicing Sikhism, by practicing Zoroastrianism, whatever religion faith you follow, but you follow honestly. Learn to tolerate the other human being, accept other beings as they are divine human beings. Guru Granth Sahib gives a message which is a message of unity, message of love, message of harmony, and respects everybody, whatever may be the caste there. There's no distinction. A very interesting feature, I'll say, that in Sikhism, we respect all the people, whatever their age is there. Even the child is to be given equal respect.
Various different religions, you see, in spite, you see, differences in philosophy, in spite of the fundamental differences, all religion carry the basically same message, that honest truth and compassion. These things, all religions carry the same message. Now that is the essence of various different religions. All this philosophy meant to promote these things, these ideas. On a big table, there will be a variety of food. You see, there, nobody quarrel due to the differences of dish. It's more variety, more useful. Then you have the choice to pick up. Similarly, as a humanity, I think different religions, more variety will be more benefit for humanity. So therefore, you see, you see not only the old religion have to use the same message, but also you see the necessary, all these different traditions, more useful. If one religion, like you see, one single type of use of food may not satisfy, you see, even you see, 10 people may not satisfy. So therefore, the more variety of religion can be more useful for variety of the people.
In religion, there are certain values which our sages were practicing in ancient days, those which we now practice, and mankind will do so in future also. In those values, there is no discrimination of caste, creed, or race, and no untouchability. There is no conflict as a result of such tradition. Acts of purity only are relevant in true religious values, which are perennial.
We see conflicts of every kind and color in the world these days, arising from ethnic and communal differences. Unity is the beauty and strength of life. Perhaps no other country as India is in a better position to give the world an example of the possibility of living in unity amidst diversity. For no nation is favored by Providence as much as India is to have such a plurality of religions, languages, social customs, and cultures. How wonderful it would then be if we could show the world that it is possible to evolve a harmony out of the abundant variety that we have in our country, a beauty out of the different and even disparate elements that we find, a mosaic of rich hues and colors. In the interest of the welfare of the nation and harmony in our nation, we must, all of us, remove from our hearts any ill will, suspicion, and hatred we may have for others not belonging to our group or community. We have to make a serious effort to come closer to one another, because no nation can prosper and make progress if the members of the household are disunited and at a loggerheads with one another. Unity brings about happiness. A happy person, a happy family, or a happy nation is basically a united one.
Caste, creed, society, geographical boundaries try to divide people. Truth and religion are the only forces which unite mankind. People of true religion today are very few, although there are millions who merely claim to be religious. However, if there are even 10 to 20,000 positive, loving people who are truly religious, the world will be fortunate.
We are sitting in a temple where you have the image of Sri Ramakrishna, who represents this great ideal of Sarva Dharma Maitri. He comes in a line of a continuous tradition reaching back to the Rig Veda, the earliest book of humanity. This country has produced
a succession of great sages and divine personalities, even kings and emperors, all of whom practiced this idea of Sarva Dharma, Maitri. We go back to the Rig Veda. There, the foundation was laid that this country, India, that is Bharat we call it, shall be the home of harmony in the world of religion. That comes from the famous mantra of the Rig Veda, Ekam Sat Vipra Bahudha Vadanti. Truth is one. Sages call it by various names. This idea inspired the Indian mind that in any society there will be differences, and these differences are necessary for enriching that society. We shall find a unity behind these differences.
Ekam Sat Vipraha Bhagudha Vadanti. Truth is one. And not ignorant people, but wise people state it in different forms. And therefore, what has got to be recognized is the fundamental unity of all religions. This was proclaimed by Swami Vivekananda in the Parliament of Religions during the end of the last century, that it is not merely of tolerance of one religion by another, it is acceptance of all religion as true. That is the basis of our Indian thought and our Indian philosophy. Our secularism is based on recognition of all religions as true, giving equal status to all religions, and the government itself not having any state religion as such. This has become necessary because we have to develop an atmosphere in which all people belonging to all religions and creeds would live in peace and harmony. But unfortunately, we find there have been religious conflicts, communal uprisings, and also a good deal of violence involved in it.
Neither their religion nor a true Muslim looks down upon another religion, nor is he injuncted by his own religion to be enemy of another religion. You will find that the Quran does not injunct enmity between religions. I'll quote to you one or two verses of the Quran and translate them for you. In one verse in the Quran, it is said, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ لَعَابِدُوا مَا تَعْبُدُونَ وَلَا أَنْتُمْ عَابِدُونَ مَا عَبُدْ وَلَا أَنَا عَابِدُونَ مَا عَبَدْتُمْ وَلَا أَنْتُمْ عَابِدُونَ مَا عَبُدْ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ وَلَيَّ دِينَ. Tell people who do not believe in me that you are worshipping a god, we are worshipping a god. You are not likely to worship our god, we are not likely to worship your god. Your religion for you and our religion for us. In another place, the Quran has said that if you are true to your own religion, you will be acceptable to me. Which means that if you follow your religion correctly and obey all that it says, it will be good enough for him, the creator.
That if we, as a follower of religion, you see, use the name of religion to destructive or to killing or to, how to say, to disharmony, then I always feel that what those original teacher, what they feel. To me, it's like the Shakyamuni Buddha or the Mahavira. Jesus Christ or Muhammad or all these, you see, the great teachers, you see, I feel definitely when they preach, you see, these new, how to say, new teaching, new religion, with such a wonderful, how to say, motivation. Therefore, if today we utilize religion for disharmony, for, you see, for, how to say, for destruction, I consider, you see, the greatest sin.
In one of his injunctions to the Muslim community, the Prophet said, if you go to a place where there is no mosque, but there is a church or a worshipping place, if they will allow you to enter there and worship with them, do so. That is to say, when you bend yourself before your accepted God, you are bending yourself to the same God to which the others bend.
It is this great national tradition of friendship between religions, harmony between religions, that found great expression in the modern period of Indian history in Sri Ramakrishna, whose image you find here. He practiced various religions and he found at the end all lead to the same goal. So there must be harmony between religion and religion. That is alone correct. So that this simple truth is repeated from the Vedic times to Sri Ramakrishna. Later on, Mahatma Gandhi also expressed the same thing, and that is India's special individuality.
Mahatma Gandhi, though a Hindu by birth, from his very childhood, he had learned to respect all religions of the world, and he said once that my Hinduism is not exclusive. It includes all that I know to be the best in Islam, Christianity, Buddhism, Zoroastrianism, and Sikhism. Not only this, but he read the scriptures of almost all the great religions of the world, and it was here that he learned his lessons in nonviolence from Srimad Rajachandra, a Jain saint. Again, it is also to be remembered that Gandhiji had a much broader vision, and he tried to work for unity throughout his life and ultimately laid down his life for that, thus becoming an immortal martyr in the cause of unity and friendship in amongst different religions. Gandhiji had said that even after independence, it is only when all these communities come together and forget their differences that we shall be able to develop what is really a national life or a national identity.
How does it begin? By praying together. Family that prays together stays together. And if we stay together, we will love each other as God loves each one of us. For the fruit of prayer is a deepening of faith. And the fruit of faith is love. And the fruit of love is service. And the fruit of service is peace. Works of love are works of peace. That is why let us bring prayer in our life. Through prayer, we receive a clean heart, and a clean heart can see God.
We need to assimilate this great teaching, derive inspiration from all these great teachings, and thus build up a country where religion is free. Everybody is free to follow one's own religion and live in harmony and friendship with people of other religions. That is the ideal we have to achieve the shortest time possible. The more people understand the truth, the more they will become centers of peace and harmony and friendship.
I request that we, all religious people, should come. We must learn to see the essence. Essence is common in the Hinduism, Islam, and Christianity, and all religions. And if we see the essence, we will come together.
According to my own experience, as a result of, you see, close, contact with a follower of different religion, I gain a lot of new experience, you see, new insight or new knowledge. So through that way, you see, naturally I developed mutual respect or genuine respect, all these different religions.
Religion plays a great part in shaping human mind and human behavior. If that religion is foul, our life will be foul. If that religion is pure, our life will be pure. Therefore, purification of religion by taking away from it all that is hateful, all that is discordant, is necessary to make for a harmonious Indian society. Every religion does teach this idea that God is one, but in practice it doesn't enter into the mind and way of the practitioners. Today it must enter into, because this is a truth. This is not a dogma, this is not a creed. This is the truth that various paths take you to the same goal. The paths are many, but the goal is one. Krishna in the Gita iterated this idea, and that is a very famous verse in the Bhagavad Gita. Ye yatha mam pravattante tam tathaiva bhajamyaham namavatma anuvartante manushya partha savasha. Through whatever paths men come unto me, Krishna is speaking as the incarnation of the divine, through whatever paths men come unto me, I receive them through those very paths. All paths eventually, Arjuna, come unto me only. Every religion has produced men and women of saintliness and great goodness and friendliness. Every religion has produced. Therefore, evidence is very clear that path is quite correct. You only continue onward with friendship, with people following other paths, saying, hello, go ahead, go ahead. We shall meet at the feet of God, for God is one.
Jivika or Jivan? Jivika jine ke liye jaruri hai ajivika. जीवन यात्रा को चलाने के लिए आवश्यक है, किंतु जीवन उससे भी ज्यादा मूल्यवान है. हम जीवन की उपेक्षा करते हैं और केवल जीविका के लिए सारी शक्ति नियोजित करते हैं.
May Almighty God shower our blessings on this great country and on humanity at large. May human beings everywhere live in peace, harmony, and friendly cooperation. Amen.
May God's blessing be with each one of you. Is my prayer for you that in love, unity, and peace, we may all be in one heart, full of love, in the heart of Jesus through Mary. So let us thank God the beautiful opportunity God has given us to work together and put our love for God in a living action by serving the poor. God bless you all. Thank you.
Let us seek the blessings of the Almighty, who is the Father of all, to love our brethren and live in peace, harmony, and affection. We should not harbor hatred and jealousy towards any fellow being. Ancient Hindu scriptures say, let the whole of mankind be happy. Our whole world is a single family. These should not remain mere words, but we should practice these on a day-to-day basis and serve as an example for emulation by the whole world.
அனைவருக்கும் எடுத்துக்காட்டும் வழியாக மார்க்கமாக வைதிக தர்மம் சனா தர்மம் இருக்க வேண்டுமாய் அனைவருக்கும் வாழ்த்தி ஆசீர்வதிக்கின்றோம். நாராயண நாராயண நாராயண.
How beautifully these people radiate the joy of love and the blissful benediction of God. Next time when you come across a so-called leader of your own community, remember to put him through the acid test before you accept him as leader. Reject him outright, even if he remotely propagates hatred and violence against others, for that is not the language of God in any religion. Beware of intruders. Remember that the devil is just round the corner, waiting to enslave your soul.
If we started with a vision of Tagore, we go back to that era again, to Subramanya Bharati. A living legend of Indian music, Srimati M.S. Subbalakshmi, renders a Bharati song. Bharati passionately appeals for harmony among people of all religions and races. White cats, brown cats, grey cats and black cats don't quarrel with one another since they all belong to one family. Cannot man learn from them? The poet wonders.
வேண்டும் ஒற்றை குடும்பம் த
The year 1947, Gandhiji's birthday was coming close. Bapuji desired that Srimati M. S. Subbalakshmi should render his favorite Meera Bhajan, Hari Tum Haro. A message was sent to Bapuji that M. S. would sing other bhajans except Hari Tum Haro, which would be sung by someone else since she did not know this one. Bapuji sent word stating, "I would rather hear this bhajan spoken by Subbalakshmi than sung by someone else." Deeply moved by the command, M.S. hurriedly learnt the bhajan, made the special recording for Bapuji, which reached him for his birthday. We have the privilege of requesting her to sing the same bhajan, hallowed by these thoughts.
Janaki Bhe
The world community honored Srimati M.S. Subbalakshmi and through her the artists of India by organizing her concert at the United Nations headquarters. His Holiness Sri Chandrasekharendra Saraswati Swamigal, the senior Shankaracharya of Kanchi Kamakoti Math, composed a song to mark the special occasion, invoking peace, harmony, and God's grace to mankind. Blessed are we to conclude this program with Srimati M.S. rendering that song.
Atmavadeva Paranapi Pashyat Yuddham Tyajat Svardham Tyajat Yuddham Tyajat Svardham Tyajat Tyajat Dayadhum Janata Ramya Dayadhum